I would like to welcome all of you to this online symposium. So it's my pleasure to be the moderator for this event. My name is Günter Wong, Education Director for Abbott. There are two things I want to remind you. Firstly, please be advised that this section will be recorded. Secondly, if you have any questions, please submit your question online. So there is a button underneath the live screen where you can submit your question. So we'll try to cover those questions at the end of the third and the fifth presentations. So may I introduce you all the two chairpersons of the online symposium. Firstly, we are having Professor Lau Chu Park, who is the immediate past president of APHRS. Since he will also be giving a presentation today, I'll let the other chair to introduce him with more details before his presentations. At the same time, we will have Professor Ian Wilcox as a chair. Professor Wilcox is a cardiologist at Royal Prince Alfred Hospital, Sydney. He is also a clinical professor of medicine at the University of Sydney. So today, Professor Wilcox will be chairing the first three presentations, while Professor Lau will be chairing the rest of the two. So now may I invite Professor Lau to open the meeting. Professor Lau, please.
Thank you, Mr. Günter. Dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this webinar on remote care of patients with cardiac implantable electronic devices. My co-chair, as you heard, is Professor Ian Wilcox from Royal Prince Albert Hospital in Australia. The Asian Pacific Heart Rhythm Society runs regular device training with virtual reality workshop in different parts of Asia Pacific and with the technical support of the Abbott. Unfortunately, our regular courses are now on hold during the COVID-19 pandemic. However, the organizers consider continued education in the webinar format can replace significant parts of our education and sharing of information without the need of traveling. There will be a series of 12 webinars on topics related to CIEDs. We have gathered an international group of experts to join our webinars. And today I have the pleasure to co-chair this and to speak in these first sessions. The purpose of the present webinar is on remote care, and we will be sharing the remote care experience both from the Asia Pacific region and also from the US. Our speakers are going to provide evidence how this can be safely and efficiently reduced in clinic visits and remote monitoring technology. And understanding how we should instrument remote care in different group of patients such as pacemakers, ICDs and CRT patients, and to discuss something of the future. So without further elaboration, may I invite Professor Wilcox to chair the first sessions of the lectures.
Good evening and good morning in some parts of the world. It's a pleasure to be involved with this important symposium. It is my pleasure to introduce the first speaker, Dr. Suneet Mittal, who earned his BA and MD degrees from Boston University, and he then did an internship and residency in internal medicine, as well as a fellowship in cardiovascular diseases at the Hospital of the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. He went on to complete a fellowship in clinical cardiac electrophysiology at the New York Hospital, Presbyterian Hospital, and the Weill Cornell Medical Center, and is board certified in cardiovascular disease, clinical cardiac electrophysiology also, and currently director of the electrophysiology laboratory and associate chief of cardiology at the Valley Hospital in Ridgewood, New Jersey, United States. And it is our pleasure to hear his presentation on replacing routine outpatient pacemaker clinic visits by remote care. Dr. Mittal.
Hello, my name is Dr. Suneet Mittal. I'm director of electrophysiology at the Arrhythmia Institute at the Valley Hospital in Ridgewood, New Jersey. Thank you for inviting me to speak at the Asia Pacific Online Symposium on Cardiac Rhythm Management, Delivering Remote Care After Coronavirus. My talk today is entitled Replacing Routine Outpatient Pacemaker Clinic Visits by Remote Care. Although remote care and remote monitoring is in vogue today in light of the COVID-19 pandemic, it's important to recognize that cardiologists have been a very early entrant into the world of remote monitoring. Pacemakers have been around for nearly 60 years, and trans-telephonic monitoring has been around for over 50 years and has really been a form of remote monitoring used in our patients with implantable pacemakers. Initial remote monitoring using trans-telephonic monitoring gave us very crude information about a patient's battery status, the rhythm at the time the trans-telephonic monitor was obtained, as well as some rudimentary information about sensing and capture. Things stood this way for nearly 50 years, or until 2002, when remote follow-up was introduced. Now, remote follow-up was an important advance because using a wanded device, for the first time, clinicians could get information that was similar to what they were getting in the office. Not only could we get actual information about the battery, higher resolution information about the rhythm and sensing and capture of the device, for the first time, we could get information about the stored diagnostics that were present within these sophisticated devices. Over a decade ago, this randomized study was performed to assess the incremental value of remote follow-up in comparison to the historical trans-telephonic monitoring. In this study, 900 pacemaker patients were randomized to remote follow-up or in-office visits and trans-telephonic monitoring to determine the time to first diagnosis of a clinically actionable event. And what we found was that a clinically actionable event was found on average 2 months earlier in the remote arm than in the control arm, suggesting that it was time to abandon trans-telephonic monitoring and move to remote follow-up. The next major advance occurred a few years later with the introduction of wireless devices that were capable of remote monitoring. Now, we could get even more earlier information about changes in battery status, critical changes in rhythm, getting information about sensing and capture, the diagnostics, and it allowed us to think about an era where we could get information about heart failure indices that may identify patients at risk for decompensated heart failure. Now, what are the benefits of remote monitoring? Well, we can get earlier detection of device and lead-related issues, information about arrhythmia detection, be it atrial fibrillation or flutter, or ventricular tachycardia or fibrillation. We can get an idea about a patient who may be at risk for developing heart failure exacerbation. And it's important that this information has translated into reduced healthcare utilization, as well as improved survival. And during this talk, I will share with you some of those data that prove these concepts. Nonetheless, we required randomized clinical studies to prove this point. Now, one of the first and most important studies involved defibrillators as opposed to pacemakers, and it was this study called the TRUST trial. In this study, patients with a defibrillator capable of wireless remote monitoring were randomized either to routine calendar-based care in the office versus automatic remote monitoring. And what you see is that when it comes to adherence with a follow-up schedule, patients with remote monitoring were much more likely to have their devices followed. This did not result in an excess of office visits. It allowed earlier detection of critical arrhythmic events, such as ventricular tachycardia and fibrillation, supraventricular tachycardias, and atrial fibrillation. And importantly, there was no signal towards an adverse safety profile. More recently, this study was published online called the Japanese At-Home Study, which extends this findings to a pacemaker population. In this study, 1,274 patients undergoing pacemaker implantation at one of 85 Japanese sites were randomized in a one-to-one fashion to either undergo remote follow-up or in-office follow-up, and the endpoint was safety. And what you see is that 2 years remote monitoring was non-inferior to a safety endpoint using a composite of death, stroke, or cardiovascular interventions, suggesting that it is perfectly safe to follow patients using remote monitoring exclusively. Now, it's hard to believe that these guidelines are nearly 5 years old, but I had the privilege of participating in the 2015 Heart Rhythm Society Remote Monitoring Consensus Recommendations on Remote Monitoring. And it's important to recognize that these guidelines suggest that all patients with a cardiac implantable electronic device should be offered remote monitoring as part of the standard follow-up management strategy with the highest level of evidence class one and the highest level of evidence level A. In fact, in lieu of a calendar-based follow-up strategy, these guidelines suggest that after implantation, patients should undergo remote monitoring where there's quarterly device monitoring that occurs routinely, and patients should be brought into the office when there is an alert condition suggesting heart failure exacerbation, the presence of an atrial arrhythmia, the presence of a ventricular arrhythmia, or once annually for the patient to be seen. Now, let's delve into some of the large observational studies that support these guidelines. Well, a number of years ago, we had the opportunity to work with St. Jude on this landmark study that looked at almost 260,000 plus patients implanted with a wireless ICD or CRT device or a wireless pacemaker or CRTP device. We followed these patients and randomized these or divided these patients into three groups of patients based on their level of adherence to remote monitoring. One group, which represented 54% of patients, were patients who were never enrolled in remote monitoring. Of the other half of the patients who were enrolled, half the patients had a high adherence to remote monitoring, and the other half had a relatively low adherence to remote monitoring. And we followed these patients to see what impact these patient profiles had on mortality. And it's important to know that in these patients, the device was the same. The only thing that differed was whether they did or did not engage with remote monitoring. Now, here you see a Kaplan-Meier curve looking at survival for the three populations. In green are the patients who were remotely monitored and were highly adherent to remote monitoring. In blue are the patients who were remotely monitored but were lesser adherent to remote monitoring. And in red are the patients who never engaged in remote monitoring. And what is seen here is survival. And what you see is that the patients with the greatest survival were those who were with remote monitoring and highly adherent. That if you were participating in remote monitoring, the amount of adherence you had to remote monitoring impacted survival. And importantly, even a little bit of remote monitoring was better than no remote monitoring whatsoever. And although you see this relationship for all devices, it's important to note that even with pacemakers and CRT pacemakers, the same signal was seen as was seen with defibrillators and CRT defibrillators, suggesting that this should be the standard of care in all of our patients with a pacemaker. Now, the other issue that we wanted to understand was what is the impact of earlier enrollment into remote monitoring? To address this issue, we looked at this study of nearly 100,000 patients, all of whom had a device, all of them who were being remotely monitored. The only difference was that the patients in purple were remotely monitored within the first 3 months of device implant, and the ones in red did not initiate remote monitoring for more than 3 months after device implant. And what you see here in the Kaplan-Meier curve is that there was a nearly 20% increase in survival in those individuals who were remotely monitored very early on in the process. And this ties into the Heart Rhythm Society recommendation that it may be beneficial to initiate remote monitoring within weeks of the CIED implant to make sure that every patient has a maximal chance to benefit from this technology. Now, survival is, of course, good, but another important outcome is the impact on heart failure, healthcare utilization. To address this question, we looked at another 100,000 patients, and again, we compared healthcare utilization in the third of patients who were being remotely monitored versus the two-thirds of patients who were not being remotely monitored. And what we found was that when patients were remotely monitored, there was an 18% lower risk of hospitalization, almost 3 days less in the hospital in any given year. And then this translates into a significant reduction in healthcare use as measured by hospitalization costs, almost a 30% reduction overall, which includes a 30% reduction in patients with a pacemaker and as much as a 45% reduction in a patient with a CRT defibrillator. Again, adding healthcare utilization to survival as important benefits to remote monitoring. Now, what are the challenges that must be overcome with remote monitoring? And the first is I've shown you several studies that show that more than half the patients are never enrolled in remote monitoring. So the first challenge is getting physicians to enroll patients into remote monitoring-based follow-up. And one of that is the whole notion, can we scale remote monitoring to follow thousands and thousands of patients? I spoke to you previously about the TRUST trial. Important to note that this study enrolled almost 1,500 patients at 105 sites, but many sites enrolled less than 10 patients, and even the biggest site enrolled only 88 patients. There's a big difference between following 100 patients in remote monitoring or following 1,000 or 5,000 patients, so the scalability of this enterprise needs to be addressed. The other is the workflow. If you look on the left, remote monitoring can involve a daunting workflow. Patients have to be educated, they have to be enrolled, they have to be scheduled, they have to be monitored. We have to communicate the findings, dismiss the downloads, integrate the information with EMR. Some billing and communication has to be done. And this can be very, very labor intensive and difficult to do for individual practices. We've long argued that to scale remote monitoring, one needs to possibly rely on third-party device and patient management vendors who can help filter the information between the physician and the patients to make it more actionable and more tolerable. And I think this is an area that requires further exploration over time. Then the second challenge is we have to ensure patients remain connected and reliably transmit data contained with their devices. Efficiency studies have largely emanated from Europe using a single home monitoring system with very different requirements for communication that may be present in other parts of the world. In the US, we know that nearly half the scheduled remote transmissions are missed due to non-compliance, and that an hour a day in offices is spent just to get patients rescheduled for these appointments. What's the solution? Well, the solution may be the smartphone. We know at this point, almost 80% of adults have a supercomputer in their pockets, and using this as the source of data transmission may greatly facilitate data transfer. So you can envision a scenario where the patient has an implantable pacemaker. Using Bluetooth technology, the data goes out to their cell phone, and that cell phone using Wi-Fi sends that to a central receiving station, and this may facilitate greatly the engagement of the patient with remote monitoring. So, ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, can we do away with clinic visits with advances in remote monitoring? I think one day, yes, but first we need to address the following. We need the systems to be far more homogeneous, and towards that end, I think smartphone-based transmissions will help a lot. Second, we need to develop systems for data intake, triage, and communication. We're now in an era of daily data transmission with devices such as loop recorders and heart failure devices, and these impose a significant burden on offices, and we need to understand how do we manage all of this data. we need to make sure that the new devices that we're implanting, such as His bundle devices, leadless pacemakers, sophisticated heart failure devices, are all optimized for remote-only follow-up and monitoring. And this has become even more important in the COVID era, where we recognize the importance of remote monitoring and follow-up of our patients. We need to resolve cybersecurity concerns, and this is an area that we covered later in this symposium. And finally, I think it's important that we have to keep patients in the loop. We need to maintain the doctor-patient relationship and make sure that they're aware of what data is emanating from their systems, and we are cognizant of sharing the information that they're sharing with us back so that they feel they're a partner in this entire process. Thank you very much for your time and attention today.
Well, that was a terrific talk from Dr. Mittal, and as all great presentations, leads to lots of questions, which we will attend to later in this session. And my next pleasure is to introduce my co-chair, Professor Chupak Lau, who is a graduate of the University of Hong Kong and currently an honorary clinical professor in the Department of Medicine in the University of the Queen Mary Hospital. He is a practicing cardiologist with an interest in interventions in arrhythmias, coronary heart disease, cardiac pacing and defibrillators. A past president of the Hong Kong College of Cardiology, is also a past president of the Asia Pacific Heart Rhythm Society, founder and advisor of the patient group Care for Your Heart. He has, of course, as we know, published a vast number of publications and acts as an external reviewer in international guidelines for clinical practice. And tonight he's going to share with us his views on detecting and management of atrial arrhythmias using remote monitoring, a challenge which we face in our daily lives as cardiologists. Professor Lau.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My task today is to summarize for you the detection and management of atrial arrhythmias using remote monitoring. Here are my disclosures. All major device companies have their own remote monitoring systems, which include remote interrogation and remote monitoring. Remote interrogation occurs as scheduled remote follow-up. On the other hand, remote monitoring ensures patient safety by alerting physicians via the internet early of any changes in the device and the patient's condition. The landmark Trust and Connect studies are summarized in this Heart Rhythm Society expert consensus document on remote monitoring in 2015. Compared with conventional follow-up identified in red, remote monitoring reduces office visits, allow earlier detection of actionable events, and an overall improved compliance of patient follow-up. Atrial diagnostics not only ensure electrical function of the atrial leads and monitoring heart rate variabilities as part of heart failure management. Importantly, such diagnostic detects atrial tachycardia or atrial fibrillation, the focus of our discussion today. This can be summarized in the form of AF burden, episode duration, ventricular rate during AF or most switches, atrial electrogram, AEGM, and atrial therapies for some device. This is a 70-year-old woman who had a dual-chamber pacemaker for sinus node disease. She developed left hemiparesis with documented clinical atrial fibrillation just for her scheduled follow-up. At that time, we did not have routine remote monitoring. A left atrial clot in her left atrial appendage during TEE was responsible for her stroke. On device interrogation, this patient had AF recorded by the device one occurrence of a stroke. Remote monitoring enables us to detect such atrial fibrillation episodes much earlier. This is from another patient with a transmission with an AF alert. This patient had AF over 24 hours. The device can be set to alert physicians when AF episodes over 24 hours or AF burden of 6 hours daily and a ventricular rate of over 100 beats per minute for 6 hours occurred. These enable earlier initiation of both anticoagulation and rate control therapy. Such AF episodes can also be further confirmed with recorded AEGM, as in this example. Are these atrial high rate episodes, also known as subclinical atrial fibrillation or SCAF, predictive of future AF complications? This is clarified by one of the several studies. For instance, in the ASSERT study that included 2,500 patients over 65 years of age with hypertension, without a history of AF, but with a pacing or ICD indication, they were randomized and were monitored for 2.5 years. About 10% of these patients has devised recorded subclinical atrial fibrillation at 3 months, and this predicted the risk of future clinical AF and stroke and thromboembolism. This slide summarizes the major landmark studies relating the occurrence of SCAF and thromboembolism. In the TREND study, a SCAF burden of over or equal to 5.5 hours per day, and in the ASSERT, SCAF longest episode exceeds 19 hours, these are predictive of future stroke or thromboembolism. Apart from the burden of AF, underlying stroke risk is also important. In this study, a higher AF burden correlated with a higher stroke risk. In addition, at each level of AF burden, a higher CHADWA score indicated by the gray bar increased the stroke risk. On the right-hand side of the bars, this is particularly evident if AF burden is over 24 hours. The ESC consensus document in 2017 recommends a CHADWA score of equal or more than 2 and the presence of SCAF over 5.5 hours are strongly recommended for oral anticoagulation. To detect AF optimally in a CIED, several considerations need to be made. These include the use of closely coupled atrial bipolar atrial sensing, high atrial sensitivity, a short PWAP, a long postventricular atrial blanking to prevent far-field R-wave sensing, validation by AEGM, and to set clinically important duration and burden of SCAF for remote alert. False positive and false negative detection of SCAF are common. In this sub-study of the ASSERT, both the rate and the duration of SCAF affect the quality and accuracy of detection. The study found that a cutoff of more than 6 minutes, a false positive rate of 17% occurred. Whereas for longer episodes, the false positive rates can be much lower. Thus, episode durations of more than 6 hours are usually quite accurate. Different manufacturers have different SCAF method of registration. For example, in this manufacturer, AF burden above a threshold, average ventricular rate, and various AF alerts can be set. There are additional issues in setting up AF alerts. In many devices, the detection of SCAF is not necessarily equal to the detection of most switches, because a more rapid transition of most switches activation is necessary to prevent rapid ventricular tracking. The number and type of EGM registration are different between ICDs and pacemakers and between different manufacturers. Commonly, they can detect the duration and the number of AEGMs are different in different manufacturers. An AEGM may be recorded as the first in and first out. They may keep the longest SCAF episode, and some manufacturers can detect both the onset and the termination of SCAF. ICM have a different type of detection of AF. There are certain features in the ICDs, for instance, if the AF rate exceeds the VT detection rate, SCAF are counted as SVT instead of AF. The subcutaneous ICD we called AF is a patient with a subcutaneous ICD with an alert of AF. AF is recorded in this SICD patient and plotted in the trend graph. And the episode was confirmed with subcutaneous ECG signals, showing AF in this patient who had underlying stroke risk requiring oral anticoagulation. Apart from stroke management, AF diagnostics are also useful to observe for AF progression. In this scientific statement of SCAF in 2019, the occurrence of the third SCAF duration is plotted against the future occurrence of AF more than 24 hours and 6 months on the left-hand side set of the graph and at 36 months on the right-hand side set of the graph. Clearly, if the initial episode of SCARF is less than an hour, identified in blue, the chance of progression at 6 months and 36 months are about 5 to 12%. Whereas if the first SCARF is between 12 to 24 hours, identified in the purple bar, AF will progress in more than 60% of the cases and reaches 80% of the cases between 6 and 36 months respectively. When AF occurs in a CRT, the percentage of bi-B pacing is reduced and survival is worsened. A pacing percentage of over 90% is important for survival in this remote monitoring study. On the right-hand side of the graph, in addition, it shows that AF further increased the mortality in patients with CRT, the lower two lines, which is mitigated if the percentage of bi-B pacing is maintained. Proversion of SCARF is associated with increased incidence of heart failure. In this sub-study of the ASSERT, SCARF progression was associated with an increased risk of heart failure hospitalization if SCARF duration exceeds 24 hours, 0.9% versus 2.5% per year. The risk factors for SCARF progression were older age, greater BMI, and per 1 hour increase in SCARF duration. These patients shows the progression of AF. In this recording, AF increases over time with development of permanent AF. This occurs with a reduction in patient physical activities, a reduction in percentage of atrial pacing, and increase in average ventricular rate. This is translated to an increase in octave counts, which is a surrogate marker of pulmonary congestion. To predict heart failure, it is well recognized that multiple parameters are necessary. In this partner's heart failure study, AF with a rapid ventricular rate, among others, are important to predict future heart failure events. And the more frequency we look at those events, the earlier we can predict heart failure. In summary, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, AF diagnostic setup for notification need to be individualized. For those with established AF under medical treatment, if AF was permanent, the ventricular rate monitoring would be of benefit for rate control. If they were paroxysmal, AF progression can be additionally monitored. In those without prior AF, notification when burden and prolonged episodes occur should be considered. Monitoring for ventricular rate and AF progression should also be beneficial. For patients with CRT, an increase in AF burden will decrease the percentage of bi-V pacing and increase heart failure events. In patients with CIEDs with concomitant poor left ventricular function, significant AF burden should prompt a review of other heart failure diagnostics. SCARF more than 24 hours may increase the risk of heart failure hospitalization. Thank you very much for your attention.
Well, thank you, Professor, for a superb talk. And now the third talk in our session is from Professor Toshiaki Sato, who is an associate professor at Kyorin University School of Medicine in Tokyo. Kyorin University was one of the pilot centers that adopted remote monitoring system when it was first introduced into Japan. He and his team have years of experience in remote monitoring and aim to improve patient outcomes in the long term by particularly, amongst other things, improving clinic workflow. So tonight, Professor Sato will talk to us about remote monitoring's role in device management and in particular, troubleshooting. Professor Sato.
I express my sincerest condolences to all the victims of COVID-19 and their family members. It is a great honor to give my presentation in webinar. Here is my disclosure. Please let me introduce the two cases with remote monitoring of shock delivery. The first case is 62 years old female. She was suffered from dilated cardiomyopathy. She had been implanted CLTD SJN promote. 9 years ago, she called us and insisted on that shock was delivered at last night. We asked her to transmit the data from her home using malin.net. See, there are no new episode. VT0, VF0. Phantom shock was diagnosed. She did not visit our patient clinic. Second case is the 36 years old male. He survived of idiopathic VF. She had been implanted ICD. 8 years ago, after taking a bath, he experienced shock. He transmitted the data. T wave over sensing was followed by inappropriate shock. I asked him to visit the outpatient clinic as soon as possible. Our aim to utilize the remote monitoring system is to detect the delivery of shock and ATP earlier. To prevent and manage inappropriate shock. To confirm the stable pacing parameters of pacemaker. And to organize the outpatient device clinic efficiently in Kyoto University, Tokyo. A total of more than 900 patients with CIEDs were enrolled in the remote monitoring network. The remote monitoring team consisted of one nurse practitioner, general, 5 clinical engineers, and EP doctors. Our team engaged in the management of the remote monitoring and the outpatient device clinic. The workflow for remote monitoring is divided into remote monitoring initiation on the left and continuation on the right. Most of the tasks were assigned to the nurse practitioner and clinical engineers. This slide indicates alert management in our university hospital. Every weekday, nurse practitioner or clinical engineers reviews each remote monitoring website and reports the alerts by email. Alert message is also sent to group email address and share with all staffs involved. This is a history of remote monitoring in Japan. It has been 12 years since the remote monitoring has been introduced in Japan. In 2009, first wireless remote monitoring with alert system became available. The reimbursement for remote monitoring was approved in 2011 and was revised last year. Consultation fee for remote monitoring follow-up, $45 in ICD, $24 for PACER as reimbursement once per month. Abbott estimated that the remote monitoring adoption reached 95% in ICD, 59% of PACER in Japan. This high prevalence of remote monitoring is supported by reimbursement in Japan. However, on April 7th, our Prime Minister declared Japan's state of emergency to cover Tokyo, Osaka, and 5 prefectures, but it's not lockdown. The state of emergency doesn't have the pause to impose penalties for unauthorized outings. On April 15th, HRS COVID-9 Task Force update indicated that goal is providing appropriate care to patients living with CIEDs while limiting exposure to staff and patients during the pandemic. Every effort should be made to perform CIED interrogation via remote monitoring rather than in-person visits. In this task force update, HRS strictly limited the outpatient visit. In-person outpatient visit for CIEDs should be limited to potentially hazardous lead or generator issues, not adequately assessed by the remote monitoring system, and absolute need for reprogramming. Our Japanese HRS recommended the postponement of visit. The postponement of face-to-face follow-up and reduction of manual device check is strongly recommended in patients with remote monitoring. If the remote monitoring has not been introduced, review the previous follow-up data and consider postponing in-person visits to device clinic. This figure indicated decline in outpatient visit in our university hospital. Using telehealth, the number of outpatient visit decreased to 1/3. Under the state of emergency, patients with pacer, remote monitoring, and age of more than 80 years old were prioritized to postpone outpatient visits. Japanese HRS approved in-person visits due to limited conditions. Immediate follow-up without delay, slow in-person visit should be considered for the following conditions: RRT or ELI, considerable changes in capture threshold, abnormal lead impedance and noise detection, ICD shocks, and sustained or pace-terminated ventricular arrhythmias, and absolute needs for reprogramming. Let me introduce two cases. The case 3, with VT recurrence during the pandemic period. He is 76 years old male with VT recurrence. ICD had been implanted and remotely monitored. In this case, we did not offer the emergency admission, but daytime visit. On May 11th, the scheduled transmission data revealed that VT was recalled and terminated by ATP on May 8th. Our nurse practitioner called him to confirm no symptoms related to VT and heart failure, prohibited from driving car, and rescheduled the visit to device clinic. 2 days later, at outpatient device clinic, we confirmed no recurrence of VT and checked his conditions. The next case was battery depletion. He was 38 years old male. He underwent pacemaker implantation for treating advanced AV block. For this case, we closely monitored the remaining battery longevity and coordinates the replacement schedule under COVID-19 pandemic. In the last October, the remaining battery longevity indicated minimum 6 months. In this May, the remaining battery longevity was 5 months, but battery impedance was increased. We suggested the patients to schedule a little bit earlier battery replacement before the winter, before the next impact. Okay. Summaries. The remote monitoring is utilized for earlier detection of appropriate shock, for reduction and management of inappropriate therapy, and for the support of outpatient device clinic. In Japan, remote monitoring reimbursement had been revised in 2020. The remote monitoring adoption reached 95% of ICD and 59% of pacemaker patients. The Heart Rhythm Society COVID-19 Task Force update proposed that every effort should be made to perform CIED interrogation via remote monitoring rather than in-person visit. HRS strictly limited the outpatient visit, and Japanese HRS recommended the postponement of visit. Although the device should be evaluated without delay in certain conditions. And this Monday, Japan continuously lifts last virus emergency controls. The first phase of Japan's battle against the novel coronavirus ended on this Monday. In conclusions, we continue to perform CIED interrogation via remote monitoring, rather than in-person visits pre, during, and post-pandemic. Thank you for your attention.
Right, so it is now the first question, answer, and discussion section. So please submit your question using the button underneath the live screen. So in this section, apart from the three speakers who have already spoken, we will also have the speakers of the next two presentations joining us. So they are Professor Qingji Qiu and Dr. Dao Yu. All right, I know Professor Wu have a couple of questions. Do you want to ask those questions?
Yes, I think we're here, of course, tonight because of COVID-19 having disrupted the meeting. And I think Dr. Mittal and the other speakers have really laid out the landscape, which began nearly 20 years ago, that brings us with the equipment to address these questions. But I would like to ask Dr. Mittal and our colleagues to comment on the uptake of remote monitoring, and also, having made a health economic argument in favour of it in many areas of the world and the Asia Pacific in particular, reimbursement has not satisfactorily addressed the economic question of how we as physicians can afford to provide this service with the reimbursement which is in place. So I'd like my, let's broaden those questions and perhaps take it from there.
So maybe I can start, sir. So it's interesting that, of course, without reimbursement, nothing is possible. But in the United States, we've had reimbursement for remote monitoring, very similar to what we heard from Dr. Sato, a reimbursement profile that's virtually identical to what's seen at the time of an in-office visit. And despite that, there's been very limited adoption of remote monitoring. So we've explored, you know, many of the reasons that limit patients' interest in this technology. And we've come up with a few central themes. The first is, for many patients, the technology barrier is high. This used to be more of an issue when you needed lots of information about routers and different analog signals. As we start to move to smartphone-based communication, I believe that the ease of connectivity will increase, and with that, patient acceptance of this technology. The second is that for many patients, they have just become accustomed to that quarterly calendar-based office visit with their primary care doctor, with their cardiologist, and they get mixed messages where those providers want to continue like that, and the electrophysiologists are telling them to move to a virtual a scenario. And so this competing interest confuses some of our patients and keeps them from engaging. And the third is that it's been hard for them to understand always the value proposition. Many of them think, okay, I'm a very compliant patient. I'm going to come to the office every 3 months. Why more than do we need remote monitoring? And it's only now that people are able to understand that these are very sophisticated devices, and the more information we can get from them online, the better it is. And I do believe that things like the COVID pandemic will ease these conversations, because those patients who had this into the pandemic had seamless care throughout this without fearing that there was any loss of monitoring at this time.
Thank you.
Right, any comments from Professor Lau or Professor Sato on these questions?
Well,
or other speakers? Yep, Professor Sato.
Yes, in Japan, last year, reimbursement was a little bit changed. And then consultation fee for the ICAD became a little bit higher, and consultation fee for remote monitoring for the patient decreased a little bit. And then I think that the reimbursement should be more needed for the patient with ICAD.
Professor Lau or other speaker, do you want to make comment before Professor Bill Kopp-Buffon to the second question.
Hi, this is Dale Yu in Dallas, Texas. Thank you for having me. Great conversation about this topic. I actually think the unfortunate COVID-19 pandemic really gives us a segue and opportunity to do a lot more than we had before in terms of remote monitoring. Having the opportunity to have done numerous roadshows around the world, I realized that reimbursement really is needed. And I think it takes us as leaders to go to the different societies as well as governments to really push for it with the data that was presented here today, showing all the benefits, and there are so many. But really in the age of COVID-19, we finally have the opportunity to present this as a value opportunity to the patients to make them really understand what remote monitoring means. In the US, we've been trying to work on this pretty diligently over the last couple of decades. I strive for 95% or higher remote monitoring in my clinics, especially for patients in rural areas. And I try to let them understand, since the majority of them, which I'll allude to in my talk, have smartphones, again, supercomputers in their pocket, as shown on the prior slides. I believe in that. And if I can give an analogy to make them understand how important and sophisticated these devices are, that monitoring is just part of it. It is not necessarily included, but it's something that almost should be mandatory given the opportunity to manage somebody on a daily basis as versus four times a year or even less than that. I think there's numerous examples of how it's helped them, but it really takes us as physicians and my staff and all our staffs to communicate that and to educate them. And in my clinic, I've done some YouTube shorts for patients to understand what it means to have a device implanted and then what remote monitoring means to them. I've also done education packets I hand out to patients after they get the device and then their remote monitoring device and machines for their houses, so they can understand in terms of the common FAQ, what questions they may have. Is it monitoring them? I also address the fact, is somebody watching them from a creepy cybersecurity standpoint, and try to allay their fears. But overall, I try to make it a value proposition. And I think with COVID-19, patients really do not want to come to clinic, or even if they do, it's more for urgent issues. And if there are all these actionable items that we have on remote monitoring and really bring in the ones that need to come in, I think that is something that really sells that point well, especially during this pandemic. So I think this is a golden opportunity for us to help ease that transition to remote care.
Right, thank you. Professor Lau?
Yes, Hong Kong has a special problem because Hong Kong is very small and people can go to an office very quickly within, say, an hour. Remote monitoring was not catching up very well initially. However, and the other issue is having internet access. At least in the few years before, we have difficulties. But now when we are moving to a cell phone type of connectivity, then things are getting better. Hong Kong have a healthcare system rather similar to the NHS of London. We don't get reimbursement for looking at remote data, but we are the major employer is the hospital authority, and all the doctors are salary doctors. But there are now an increasing drive for pacemakers, for instance. The need for remote care is important in this COVID era, is remote interrogation without the need to go to the clinic. But the way we started is to impress on the patients that we are not doing so much these days for what is wrong with the pacemakers, ICDs, and CRTs. Rather, we are looking at the occurrence of changes in their condition, particularly atrial fibrillation, heart failure, or ventricular tachycardia, that is critical for the healthcare, for the care of the health. And in this regard, we are increasingly getting people who are interested to join this, remote monitoring.
And also, Professor Lau, you made a very strong point about atrial fibrillation and stroke risk and heart failure, and of course the implementation of high levels of biventricular pacing and detecting heart failure compensation. So in this journey from early phase remote monitoring to the current day, electrophysiologists and those interested in cardiac rhythms are moving into the area of heart failure and stroke prevention. And it's an exciting time. And the health economics, of course, of preventing stroke or heart failure admission are quite different to simple bradyarrhythmias or even treating tachycardias, are they not?
I agree. This is certainly a very important area, is the disease management part of remote monitoring. There are so many things that can happen. The atrial fibrillation progression, whether we should be treating or using things like medications or sometimes even ablation to prevent atrial fibrillation progression before it is too late. And early intervention of such progression may help us to maintain sinus rhythm and avoid underpacing in CRT and the development of heart failure in the future. So we have a lot of opportunity, especially as EP person, to combine all these parameters. Obstructive sleep apnea, for instance, they can also be detected by some devices, and these obviously will be an important point for intervention as well. So we are very remarkable in the amount of sensors we are getting.
And perhaps that put to the panel, because Dr. Mittal made the point about third-party providers and small practices find it difficult to provide this sort of service. Our group, which is quite large, provide services to other practices on a goodwill basis, but essentially the move into machine learning with physician oversight is probably where this will go. And I'd be interested to hear what other people's experiences are of starting that journey into getting some automatic help, if you will, rather than just, you know, message compression, if you will.
I can take that to start, sir. So I think that when you have following so many devices, especially the increased burden of loop recorders with daily data transmission, trying to filter and separate the signal from the noise is going to be extremely important to be able to run time-efficient clinics. We actually recently, at the Heart Rhythm Society meetings, posted an abstract that we did with our first foray into using artificial intelligence in an environment of loop recorder patients, and were able to show a 70% reduction in the number of false positive events that were presented to a physician for review, with less than a 1% drop in true negative episodes. And I think that this is the future with respect to this, that the alerts emanate from the device, hit a server, but then before that information gets to you, there's this additional filter that will likely be AI-based, will then reduce some of the noise and then allow you to really hone in on the signal or the actionable data. And I think that this will be a big advance in our ability to care thousands of patients with remote monitoring, which is clearly where our field is going.
Fantastic. Excellent comments. Other panel members wish to contribute, particularly with their Asia-Pac experience and the uptake of remote monitoring in the region and perhaps where they see the future going?
Professor
Ching? Hi, CK from Singapore. I'd like to add a few comments. I think the Asia-Pac region is so diverse. You have regions like Australia, perhaps New Zealand, Japan, and in some centers in Singapore that is that takes up remote monitoring for CIED patients in high volume or rampantly. And then there are other centers and countries in the region that are still doing the in-office check. You know, so in centers that are already looking at lots of reports, lots of false positive data, and AI-based triage mechanism may be useful. Whereas those that are yet to adopt remote monitoring, they really have to look into the reimbursement that is available, make it work, that the patients see a good value proposition with remote monitoring. And thirdly, in some of these countries, in regions, a lot of the device care and programming is really taken on with help from the industry. And hence, we need to reconcile who owns the data, who does it, and who wants to take charge of the device programming and parameter changes in such centers. I have a radical idea, actually. A third-party solution or a work solution may be suitable in the Asia-Pac region, in smaller centers that do not do lots of remote monitoring, perhaps plant 50 to 100 devices a year. Then a third-party vendor provides device checks and care. The reports are streamlined, tabled, you know, represented or presented in a way that it is emailed to the attending doctor. That might be a good proposal because you take the work and the burden of looking after these patients off the busy physician who may not be just doing pacing work, but they're doing a lot of general cardiology. They're doing other general medical work as well. So I would even propose, if there is a vendor who would like to propose and provide a third party solution, that may be a viable option in the region. Over to you.
Right, I've got one question from the audience. So it's about patient education. It's about what methods for patient education can be employed to make them more familiar to remote care in the region where it has not been introduced yet. Anyone want to take this question?
Sure, I can start. So we now believe that the education should start before the device implant so that patients start to understand that there is a process beyond just the implant of the device, that how the device is going to be followed is going to be very critical and may actually impact their outcomes in terms of staying out of the hospital and their overall well-being. So we initiate that education process prior to device implant, and we ensure that following device implant, we know exactly where the patient will get their device monitored. We make sure that they understand that there's a difference between remote monitoring and follow-up. And I think that those conversations have been very helpful in advancing the needle and getting to what Dr. Yu said, which is getting to the goal of having more than 95% of patients engaged in this platform.
Hi, this is Dale Yu. I completely agree with those statements as well. I would say that the patient education should begin early. What we have routinely done is while we're explaining the natural progression of what will they should expect after the implant goes in, which is ultimately what they are worried about, the surgery portion of that, we also explain to them what they should expect from a remote monitoring standpoint. I will see them back in 2 weeks afterwards, at which time we reiterate the remote monitoring aspect of it. In some cases, the patients may not have gotten their remote boxes, so that this is when I would give this to them so that we can increase that adherence rate. In terms of those comments about a third-party vendor, in the United States, we seem to have many of them coming up every single day. There's another company trying to take on the remote monitoring as reimbursement does exist. It's not huge, but it is enough to justify the business model. I would like to add on to that and say that as more remote monitoring centers pop up, that volume does matter. If there's a small implanter with 5 to 10 patients, there needs to still be a thought process about how it is rolled out and set up. So the understanding of how many patients it takes to have how many employees to look at that, whether it's a nurse practitioner or if it's a technologist or if it's a physician themselves, there should be some type of protocol before a center starts to roll out remote monitoring. And I think a large part of that includes education to understand what materials you would hand to patients, prior to surgery, after surgery, and again at the 2-week follow-up. Something easy that we've done, again, has been recording short videos on YouTube so that they have some education as they have access to their smartphones. They can see their own physicians talking about this, and you can refer them to a site. And these aren't very difficult things to set up in this day and age, and very cheap and quickly being able to do education for your patients.
Well, they're terrific comments. And I think patient education is the key to taking it up and having it continue. It's disappointing to set it up and then not be able to continue it. And obviously demonstrating to patients the value of it. And obviously there are concerns about cybersecurity, which is going to be addressed in another presentation. But I think it is important, isn't it, to explain to patients what the limits, what the opportunities, but the limits are of this. So now, I will often explain that this is a supplement, not a substitute for other care, and we can frame the expectations so that we can meet or exceed them rather than fall short over them. But in the interest of time, Professor Lau and colleagues, we may have to move on to the next section.
Well, my pleasure to start the next sessions and introduce our first speaker, Professor Ching-Chi Kong. He is a senior consultant with the Department of Cardiology and a director of cardiac EP and pacing at the National Heart Center, Singapore. Professor Ching graduated with his bachelor degree in the National University of Singapore in 1995, and he is certified cardiologist in 2004. Professor Ching completed his clinical fellowship in cardiac EP and pacing at the Cleveland Clinic in 2007, and he is currently teaching at the Duke NUS Graduate Medical School as an adjunct associate professor. We have the pleasure to have CK today with us, and he is talking about an important disease management, remote management of heart failure patients with CRT device. CK, please.
Good evening. Thank you for the kind introduction. My task is to talk on remote monitoring in heart failure patients with CRT devices. These are my disclosures. We do know that CRT is an established treatment in patients with heart failure. They do require regular device evaluation to achieve effective CRT delivery. Along the course of follow-up, doctors need to manage their clinical conditions that may affect CRT delivery. Despite what we could do at this day and age, responders can be seen up to 30% in patients with CRT. In centers that provide CIED follow-up, especially if you're able to provide remote monitoring, it is a Class 1 recommendation that remote monitoring should be performed for surveillance of lead function and battery conservation, especially in patients with a CIED component that has been recalled or is on the advisory. It is useful to reduce the incidence of ICD shocks, as useful for early detection and quantification of atrial arrhythmias. As such, remote monitoring of CIED should be standard practice in centers that offer and are capable of providing remote monitoring. The altitude study reported survival rates in close to 195,000 patients who receive either an ICD or a CRT. Of note, those who were on remote follow-up of their device data, they do better than those who are not. You can see from this graph that patients with an ICD while on the network or CRT while on the network do better than patients who are not on the network. It suggests that remote follow-up of device data is associated with excellent survival. Combined diagnostic in a CRT report could reliably identify heart failure patients at risk of heart failure episodes or hospitalization. In a partner's HF study, patients meeting any two of the listed criteria in the previous 30 days are considered to have a positive diagnostic if they had changes in their fluid index. As such, they had prolonged episodes of atrial fibrillation or tachycardia, or the ventricular rate during persistent atrial fib or flutter or tachycardia is raised at beyond 90 beats per minute, if the patient had remained inactive or the night heart rate were elevated for 7 days, the heart rate variability was reduced, or the degree and percentage of CRT pacing is less than 90% for 5 or 7 days, or they receive an ICD shock. In patients with a positive diagnostic, they were at least 5.5 times more likely to have a heart failure hospitalization with pulmonary congestion in the next 30 days. We mentioned that up to 30% of patients with CRT remain non-responders. If we look at this report out of Cleveland Clinic, Mullins looked at patients who reported at the CRT clinic and try to elucidate why patients do not respond to CRT. You could see that just under 1 in 2 had a suboptimal AV timing. That needs to be optimized. 1 in 4 has less than 90% biventricular pacing. About 1 in 3 patients has some form of arrhythmia, be it atrial or ventricular, that affect effective CRT delivery. Hence, patients with CRT needs regular device evaluation and perhaps optimization to effect good CRT delivery. Let me give you some real life examples. This is one patient who received a CRT in April 2016 for typical indications. He had a triggered transmission in December 2017. It showed low bi-V pacing from 99% to 88%. There was increased atrial tach or flutter with increased mode switches. A review of the EGM would show that there is atrial flutter with variable AV conduction. It was reviewed in the clinic, and we do know that atrial flutter with heart failure or depressed EF is a bad thing. So he underwent catheter ablation for atrial flutter, and a scheduled transmission in 2018 February shows that the bi-V pacing has increased to more than 19%, it's 97% this time, and they were back to the baseline of less than 1%. Mode switches are all atrial tach, atrial flutter. This is another example, a patient who received CRT for poor EF and AV block. About 3 months after he received the implantation, the bi-V pacing were recorded only at 75%. He had a PVC of 10% burden with inappropriate mode switches due to far field R wave sensing. This is the events locked, 10% PVC, about 0.7 million counts, with a reduced bi-V of only 75%. A review of the EGM would show that although the PVC count was 10%, it is likely to be underestimated as some PVCs coincided with the onset of atrial depolarization. There's also inappropriate mode switches due to far field R wave sensing. And you can see over here, mode switches where the atrial channel senses the far field R wave. And we were able to alter the device parameters, start medication to suppress the PVC so that we could overcome some of these problems in order to deliver effective CRT therapy. These are some of the trials and evidence of remote monitoring. Of note, I have circled those involving CRT patients. Time does not permit me to have offer a extensive review of the literature, but enough to say that remote monitoring does reduce patient risk. In patients with ICD or CRT, there is a reported or potential 50% lower risk of all-cause mortality. In retrospective data, it suggests a 27% reduction in all-cause mortality over 3 years. It has the potential to reduce hospital admissions. It may improve clinical outcomes while reducing healthcare costs. Up to 36% reduction in cardiac or device-related emergency department visits or hospital visits. You could potentially reduce 66% of hospitalization related to atrial fibrillation or stroke, a potential reduction in cost a hospitalization and a reduction in the mean length of stay for such patients. We could incorporate other pressure monitor devices in the management of heart failure patients. One such device is a pulmonary artery pressure sensor. When implanted in patients with heart failure and they have their PA pressure monitored, if the fluctuations demand in the intervention, they could effectively reduce or prevent a unneeded hospitalization due to heart failure. In fact, we could use non-implantable devices. We could measure patients with heart failure, and we monitor their heart rate, their weight, their blood pressure. You could measure their biomarkers. If you want to record and measure their troponins, their BNP, or the INR if they're on warfarin. Or you could use a watch to record the ECGs or a suitable portable ECG machine or recorder to monitor the heart rhythm. It seems telecardiology in patients with heart failure seems promising. However, the remote monitoring trials in patients with heart failure with a CIED have produced mixed results thus far. The meta-analysis of this series of trials neither favor remote monitoring or in-office checks. And why is that so? Let me draw you to this concept of telecardiology. On one hand, you have non-implanted devices, biomarkers, portable recorders, implanted devices of a suitable patient. The data that is generated or recorded will then need to be transmitted to be it a secure online server, and this data needs to be triaged by a either third-party provider or the respective healthcare professionals in the device clinic. Now, this data needs to be triaged, needs to be interpreted, needs to be reconciled with their medical conditions, and then there must be a feedback loop where patients need to be contacted after the data is reviewed, whether intervention ought to be instituted to avert a potentially adverse event. This is what I call the black box of telecardiology. It is a tool. Telecardiology or remote monitoring is not treatment. And what happens in this black box would determine the outcome or the success of a remote monitoring system or service. Now, the question would be, will your hospital provide a 24/7 system or is it a office hour system? Will the hospital or the device clinic be the primary provider for such a service, or would it be outsourced to a third party? Would it be an automated transmission? Would patient call in? And if they do call in, is it manned by a person or some AI-based system? Importantly, what is the response time to any of this transmission? And last, not the least, reimbursement plays a big role. But I believe remote monitoring is the way to go for patients with CIED. And when you want to start such service, I suggest and recommend that you start a pilot study or a project so as to determine what goes into that black box of telecardiology. We did one. We asked ourselves, are patients compliant to remote transmission? And we realized that they usually are compliant, but those with a non-wireless system are often late. We're glad to know that majority, just under 99% of the transmissions are reviewed by our healthcare professionals. And fortunately, the number of actionable alerts are not much higher compared to that of an in-office check. Of note, only 1.8% require some form of intervention. And the remote monitoring transmissions are similar to in-office checks in up to 97% of the time. And with that, we continued to look at the data. And we're glad to say that over the years, the actionable alerts have remained at about 4% compared to 10% for those with in-office check. I mean, there are various reasons. For example, there are older devices, patients without remote monitoring, and hence older devices may have more lead issues. The time of even occurrence to its detection, and hopefully its intervention is obviously lower in patients who are on remote monitoring. And that's is an encouraging data. It also reduced clinic visits in my center. Over the years, the number of remote monitoring has gone up. The total checks have gone up, but the proportion of home monitoring continued to rise. And this allows us to spend more time in the office on patients who require some form of troubleshooting. And with the current climate of COVID-19, I think such a system is beneficial to both patients and physicians. So with the pilot study, we concur with most of the studies out there that it is a safe alternative to in-office checks. It provides remote surveillance and detects early potentially harmful events, and it reduces outpatient clinic workload. Ladies and gentlemen, let me conclude by reminding everybody that remote monitoring in patients with CIED is a tool. It is not treatment. When done properly, with the various components of your black box of telecardiology answered or filled in, it is safe. It can potentially improve survival. It does reduce clinic visits. And in patients with CRT, it monitors CRT delivery. It manages clinic conditions so as to provide effective BIV pacing in patients who need them. It definitely detects events early. It does reduce shocks, reduce ER visits, hopefully heart failure hospitalization, heart failure survival, and definitely detect new onset atrial arrhythmias or burden of atrial arrhythmias that you may intervene and hopefully reduce adverse events. With that, I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, CK. This is really an excellent presentation. I'm sure you have all a lot of questions. Maybe we defer it after the next talk. I would like to invite the next speaker, Dr. Del Yu, to give us his next insight on cybersecurity. Dr. Yu is a graduate in the Texas Health Science Center, and he was trained in Emory University in Atlanta, not only in cardiac EP and devices, but also in nuclear cardiology, a very important and interesting mix. Dr. Yu not only implant pacemakers, defibrillators, and CRT, but he is also doing laser extractions, everything related to devices, and he has done a lot of ablations without the use of radiation. We are delighted to have Dr. Yu to talk to us about the future of remote monitoring and cybersecurity considerations. Dr. Yu, please.
Thank you, APHRS, for having me again to give a talk on digital health and cybersecurity. It's a topic near to my heart. And I think as we're doing more and more to increase our awareness about health overall, especially in these times of COVID-19, it's a great honor to be able to present this topic to all of you as well. And again, thank you to all those health providers out there that are fighting COVID-19 as we're doing on the front lines. And without further ado, I'm Dr. Dale Yu from Dallas, Texas, and I'm honored to talk about digital health as well as integration with cybersecurity. Here are my disclosures. My background is in engineering, which has been able to meld my love of technology with medicine. And again, great honor to be able to put those topics together and do what I want to do. So this is a busy slide on purpose. It shows how digital health revolution has taken over, and especially in times of COVID-19, the unique time in all of our lives that we never had to face. We're utilizing technology every day, again, doing Zoom meetings like this, or utilizing remote monitoring or other types of technologies we have in order to connect with our patients and better help them. It's very important to understand them, whether or not we like it or not. It's definitely amongst us and helping us in most ways. We are more familiar with wearables than we ever have before. It is giving us more data than we've ever had. Whether it's an Apple Watch or Fitbit, we try to check our own health as we're trying to improve ourselves. We're also understanding that patients have access to so many technologies, and understanding that and the securities around them are very important as well. We are all connected with social media as well. The younger generations aren't the only ones on social media now. Patients are connecting through different educational websites and social apps in order to help us better communicate with them and to us, like And so it's very important as physicians to understand what that platforms they're on and how this information is being disseminated to better help them and us. So 25 billion connected devices exist as of this year, and probably more because of everything that's going on with COVID-19. 8 zettabytes of data are utilized every single day, and that is a tremendous amount of data, which means more storage out on the cloud and in permanent databases. But understanding that there's that much data out there also means that there's challenges with security. There's also 150,000 apps out there on health alone. There's wireless sensors, there's mobile connectivity, there's social networking, genomics, imaging. These all utilize the digital health revolution to help us integrate this data to better help our patients. There are many industry challenges as well in healthcare, because in the United States alone, 17% of the U.S. gross domestic product is in healthcare, and it's growing faster than economy by quite a scale. There are a lot of challenges with minimizing errors, as that is the 8th leading cause of death in the U.S. as well as worldwide, and 250,000 people die every year due to errors. And we're hoping that technology can help us lower that number in the future, as it's all about innovation and integration technology. We know that chronic conditions drive healthcare costs as well. This, again, is not a unique problem to the U.S., but it is all around the world. As I've traveled to different markets, it is something that labors us all and causes us a lot of harm, as we know that chronic conditions continue to increase as we live longer. We also have more hospitalizations, more contacts with the healthcare system, which means that we have to be better about our ability to keep them out of the hospital, as well as utilizing technology to do so. As a result, we can see that there's no coincidence that digital health funding continues to go up as well. Even in the NIH has decreased funding in almost every other category, it has increased its digital health funding. So what else is taking the world by storm is the coronavirus and COVID-19, which has really changed the way that we have to utilize our healthcare needs and our abilities to take care of our patients. Along that comes remote monitoring, especially dear our hearts, electrophysiologists. This is something that we have been utilizing for decades. And this technology continues to improve so that we can take care of our patients better as well. As you can see here, this is some of the older ways of utilizing what we have. And that still includes doing a remote transmission from a box that's near a patient on the nightstand. But that usually goes into a database, and then that database is then transmitted to the physicians, and then that data then is utilized to take care of their patient. Remote monitoring of devices can definitely improve patient outcomes. We know adoption adherence to remote monitoring remains suboptimal, and adherence to remote monitoring is such a greater benefit. Numerous peer-reviewed published studies have demonstrated the benefits of remote monitoring. There's early detection and evaluation of clinical data and device-related events. It reduces in-person clinic visits as well as hospital visits, and no change in patient safety, improves patients' quality of life overall, and improves long-term patient survival. It's been shown to improve outcomes, especially in the heart failure community who are quite vulnerable, makes for less hospitalizations, less mortality in the sickest patients. The frequency of utilization is also very important, as it allows for details that allow for a dedicated staff to then utilize to help these patients. Champion trial with CardioMEMS showed benefit for both HFpEF and reduced heart failure patients, ejection fraction heart failure patients as well, by reducing hospitalizations and mortality. Improved clinician efficiency and percentage of evaluation requiring clinical actions are important. We utilized remote monitoring in the past to determine whether or not the patient needed to come into the clinic. We also brought them into clinic to see if there was something else going on during the times that they weren't in clinic. We now know that if they have remote monitoring at home, they actually have a triggered event that these actions were often actionable. These actual triggered events were actionable more than half the time. Whereas if you brought them to clinic, about only 1 in 10 were actually actionable, because the event probably already happened days prior or even weeks prior to them coming to clinic. ESC did a great job with this review article of 7 randomized trials looking at remote monitoring to determine whether or not there was improvement, especially in the sickest population of the heart failure patients with CRT devices and defibrillators. As you can see here, it was initially seen that it was kind of split, but when you take a look at a little bit closer, you'll see that 3 randomized trials utilized daily automatic remote monitoring data collection, as opposed to the other ones were averaging about a week. As you can see, there's definitely favoring remote monitoring when you actually had daily automatic remote monitoring data collection. Growth in population with only wireless telephones continues to explode as well. Patients do not have landlines as much as they used to. And in fact, children with the millennia and further on have even more wireless service connections only. As you can see here, and this is up to 2012, this number has gone over 50% now. It was at 40%, and all adults with wireless only service was at 34%. Again, approaching 50% and above at this time. Mobile growth also continues through this year. As you can see that there are patients and people all around the world that have mobile phones that don't necessarily have electricity. As you can see here, there are more people with mobile phones, up to 5.4 billion, than patients with electricity, than people with bank accounts, and people with running water. So it's quite amazing that almost everyone's connected with a mobile phone. Hence, you can see the connection between a mobile phone and an app, and possibly allowing us to help deliver healthcare in a more efficient, better way. Smarter connectivity through these technologies allows us to help more patients in a more meaningful way as well. The ConfirmRx was the first of its kind a couple of years ago that allowed us to use app-based technologies as opposed to remote monitoring hardware at the house. They could use their smartphone or to transmit data to a physician's office fairly quickly in real time. It could go through cell phone services or through Wi-Fi. And again, it would go to the cloud, which then would be transmitted to the patient's office, taking out the whole connectivity that you have to be next to a device at your house at a particular time in order to transmit that data. As we all understand that daily transmissions are better than weekly transmissions, well, real-time transmissions are better than daily transmissions as well due to that delay. The BlueSync data, the study that just came out from Medtronic at HRS this year, the virtual HRS, showed similar outcomes and improvements with their pacemaker platforms with the app as well. The evaluation was the prospective multi-center trial looking at the success rate of scheduled transmissions in pacemaker patients utilizing the app for 12 months. The transmission success was compared to three different modalities of bedside manners that are we using in status quo now. And those that use the app were much more likely to adhere to the pacemaker remote monitoring schedule. We found that they completed 94.6% of scheduled transmissions, which were superior to the other three categories as illustrated here. This showing us the three categories of controls that we use, including those in the status quo and those adding the BlueSync technologies to a home monitor. And then of course the app version of it as well. When you look at the outcomes here, it's remarkable to see that the BlueSync evaluation group of an app was 94.6% able to transmit at a scheduled time, as opposed to the traditional way of having a box at home, 56.3%, 77% when you had BlueSync on at that home site. And again, for ICD and CRT devices, it was a little better at 87.1%. Overall, when you looked at the real world evaluation as well, as opposed to those directly in the trial utilizing the app, exactly how the study outlined, the numbers are pretty close. So utilizing the app seemed to be much better overall and translated to real world as well. And despite the huge potential, healthcare is always a little slower in adaptation and adoption of these technologies, and we have to understand that. And issues with privacy and cybersecurity are only going to make these issues even worse. This cartoon kind of illustrates some of the barriers we had alone with just EMR delivery from a paper charting system. So many concerns about privacy, insurances, financial institutions, hospitals, and networks. And again, of course, the medical records that belong to patients. As you look at this, you can see why it's so complex and why security concerns are actually paramount, because it is not an easy system to navigate. Technology challenges also exist because there's too many computers and servers, too many applications, the mobility of devices is rapidly changing, as well as the fact that patients continue to get more and more devices, physicians get more and more devices. And again, there's a serious lack of redundancy and actually follow through on software on these devices as well. Privacy pyramid is huge, meaning that there's concerns at all levels for patient privacy and data breaches that occur almost every year. In the news, we see that there are billion numbers that have been lost or patient data that's been lost. And again, this is something that needs to be worked on as we get better and better and more entrenched in technologies. So cybersecurity has been an issue and really brought to light in 2012 when Barnaby Jack hacked the insulin pump and showed that was possible. It also demonstrated that remotely, he can access a pacemaker and deliver potentially an 830-volt shock. It was actually a pacemaker defibrillator. And again, a demonstration, not in a live human being, but these possibilities will open our eyes wide And that started the snowballing of allowing us to understand that this is an integral and necessary and integral part of technology expansion. 2013, President Obama called for an executive order to collaborate to project or to protect infrastructure from cybersecurity threats, including healthcare. KPMG showed that 81% of healthcare institutions in 2015 had been hacked at least once in the prior couple of years, and they didn't necessarily feel adequately prepared. And Black Hat Conference in 2016 showed the white hat hackers, Rios and Butts, showing that their vulnerabilities in Medtronic systems and the programmers and software that was being downloaded on them. 2017, St. Jude Medical also had issues with their firmware and some of their devices. Around the same time, WannaCry ransomware was really taking down the UK health system as well as some of the East Coast systems in the US. We know in 2016, Muddy Waters near the end came out with reports that St. Jude devices had encrypted device data that could be pulled off of Merlin remotely, including IP addresses and SSH keys. Made people worried that there was also some vulnerabilities to their devices, namely their ICDs, that blasting RF could deplete the batteries and cause rapid pacing as well. Some of these vulnerabilities were disproven. However, these are the things that continue to come to light because of the media, as well as the fact that technology was getting rapidly expansive and understanding those technologies were getting more difficult because there's so much out there. We know that the Medtronic software update issues with Carolink occurred right before I presented this at APHRS 2 years ago in Taiwan. It showed that there were vulnerabilities in the downloading of the actual OS software systems onto the programmers themselves. Almost all reported intrusions are through exploitations of known vulnerabilities and configuration errors, meaning that these are things we could have fixed. And if infrastructure was there, the healthcare system, a private clinic, or even in my own house, we, you know, so many times we forget or do not want to upgrade to the next OS or put a new patch in because we think that's going to be more vulnerable or takes up more space on our computers or our phones. It makes them more slower in adaptation. They don't move as fast. But in all truth, we know that most of these exploitations occurred through systems that are just listed on the websites that we know that it existed prior to that. And safeguards, countermeasures don't necessarily really adapt to that or solve that issue. It affects us all. Personally, it affects us as healthcare providers, as well as the patients themselves regarding information, security of devices, possible updates and threats in the office. As we are remote monitoring centers, it can impact us there, the data that we get and how we store that data, hospitals, device clinics there, as well as implantation that just recording the device data is done on a computer system that potentially could be hacked and vulnerable as well, as we saw with WannaCry. 8 billion IP addresses in the world are used every day by citizens. But remember that these IP addresses can be hacked or utilized by malicious parties as well and enter them into our healthcare systems fairly easily. And the life cycle of software is much shorter than hardware, which is an issue because, again, we almost wait until we get a new computer or a new system before a new software is installed. And again, that allows for a lot of vulnerabilities. Different societies around the world are finally tackling this issue as it becomes a big issue. And luckily, every year at Black Hat, a larger and larger section of this is devoted to healthcare issues, whether it's apps or devices themselves. And I think this is a good thing because, again, as the GDP of all countries continues to explode in terms of healthcare issues and a portion of their GDP, we also need to grow in the cybersecurity arena so that we can tackle these growing issues. Medical agencies and societies have done well to address some of the website concerns of their own encryption. However, overall, patients and healthcare providers themselves are left in the dark. The recommendations to us are not necessarily that clear, and that's because there's no cohesive algorithm and awareness for all societies and all different countries. Black Hat started to show that HL7 is what we utilize in almost all our EMRs, the stored data, that has vulnerabilities in itself. And understanding these vulnerabilities are the only way to understand how to address our patients' concerns as they see more and more of these stories in the media and on mainstream TV. These cyber challenges, there are many in healthcare, but they're unique as well as we have privacy concerns as well. In a deeply seated legacy system of technologies, as we're not upgrading our softwares and hardware often takes many years to upgrade as well. Healthcare organizations also have deep-rooted problems with their whole accountability from employees to IT workers to allow for an efficient manner of solving these software issues. There's issues with accuracy and safety also because of the fact that every system is different. And overall, there's many costs to implement these safety concerns. So again, that causes our cybersecurity to be sometimes vulnerable. There's, of course, many wireless concerns. As we're talking about doing more and more wirelessly, using our cell phones and Bluetooth and long-range RF and so on and so forth, there's some concerns here as there's lack of user authentication, weak encryption, there's poor network management. There's also vulnerability attacks, man-in-the-middle, rogue access points in session, hijacking are just three of the more common ways. Basically, all culpability comes to the fact that there's vulnerabilities because we don't understand the technologies. There's too many steps along the way in order to secure the systems. There's lots of possibilities of what we can do with the technology we have now, including what we know about cybersecurity and the different technologies for remote monitoring. Current status is that we're able to do a good job with remote management of our implantable devices, including loop recorders, pacemakers, and defibrillators. Diabetic devices already are transmitting our sugars through a Libre device or one of the other competitors currently on the market in a much more ubiquitous way and much easier for patients to manage their own healthcare in terms of insulin management. We know that scales and blood pressure cuffs are also are included in the Bluetooth mainstream in order to get us data fairly simply to our phones and to our apps. There's numerous wearable technologies also utilizing Bluetooth technologies to allow us to get that data and then that data to our physicians and healthcare providers so they can better help us as well. Soon we'll be able to utilize heart failure devices such as CardioMEMS in order to get that data real time when patients have symptoms. Hopefully near future, we'll also have data coming real time from assist devices themselves so that they can tell us if there's an issue, impending issue with the motor or the speed or the actual delivery of oxygen and circulation for the cardiac outputs. This is something that should be readily available and can be the technology we have. And in the future is huge in terms of what we can do and the possibilities are endless. All the implantables that we talked about, including those for other things such as back pain, spinal stimulators, brain implants, sleep apnea devices should all be connected, Bluetooth or RF in order to give us that data and to help us manage that those clinical syndromes and issues quickly in real time. And remote support for devices and cases may also exist. As we know, labs are starting to have more independence. If we have a troubled case or a difficult time doing something with a device, we may be able to connect through an app in order to talk to our fellow reps and clinicals so they can give us assistance through that app, which would be secured and being able to deliver data as well through that. So that's something that's being worked on and definitely something that is plausible in the near future as well. So overall, is it worth it to be connected in so many different ways with an expansive network of technology with all these cybersecurity concerns I've outlined? The pros are many. Rapid information is something that we can rapidly clinically help our patients as well. There's better overall adoption of monitoring by patients when you have rapid connectivity with them. It gives patients a sense of responsibility and ownership of their own health as well, which helps us in turn. There's lots of data to act upon as well. Better treat them to keep them out of the hospital so that I can manage that in a way that is meaningful to them. However, lots of data is not only a pro, but it's also a con. As there is too much data out there, sometimes to understand how to manage it is an issue in itself. Too many data points that may conflict. There's cybersecurity concerns that I've outlined for the last 10 minutes. There's privacy concerns as well. And again, too much data is not always meaningful when it's not all good data either. So where are we to bridge us to success into the future in a safe manner? I think it's very important to have a comprehensive cybersecurity program within each institution, practice, office, for each provider themselves. And you need to understand some of the basics here so you're able to deliver information to patients. I know that more frequently in the last couple of years especially, patients are wondering, what does this mean to me that I have a device in myself that you're remotely monitoring? Is this safe? Is this something that can be hacked? Is this something that is going to cause me harm in the future? Understanding the answers to these simple questions are very important to be successful in order to have a successful remote management program. Really being able to understand how to secure the data transmission as well, and to have a dedicated staff and office basically that is dedicated to device management, remote management of data. So we're doing more and more telemedicine. The remote monitoring side of it in itself of devices is very difficult as there's lots of data coming in. And having a cohesive network, understanding how that data is going to be filtered and clinically reacted upon, I think is very important to understand as well. To have a nice algorithm for that, to triage the symptoms and understand how to take care of these patients. As patients continue to live longer, there are more devices that are implanted in them. Understand how we manage that, I think, is the probably number one step in this management of all this. And again, collaboration with your colleagues, understanding what your societies have to say, but updates in cybersecurity are also very, very important. But overall, I think we could be very successful, especially in this day and age of COVID-19. Everything that's going on out there, it's a very scary world for our patients and physicians alike. I think understanding that vulnerabilities will also always exist, but to understand what these vulnerabilities are based on and to be able to help those that don't understand it know one more thing that they didn't know yesterday and the day before, again, is how we're going to get through this as technology continues to expand and hopefully in a meaningful way that helps us all. But overall, I think it's something that is going to help us transition in a successful way. Thank you again for listening to the talk on cybersecurity and devices. And if you have any questions after this talk, please feel free to reach out to me by email or approaching me through any of the websites that we have set up for our patients as well. But again, it's an honor to have spoken to APHRS in this unique manner, and I look forward to speaking and collaborating with you soon as well. Thank you so much.
This is a very eloquent talk and with a lot of insight to the future. Thank you, Dell. Well, maybe we need to start to discuss on this. I would like to invite all the panelists to join as well. But to start with, I would like to ask CK, Professor Cheng, what do you think about the lack of uniform outcome of remote monitoring on heart failure management for CRTs? Is it related that we do not have a good sensor or the proper sensor to detect heart failure, or we are not looking at them frequent enough, or that we are not acting on them appropriate enough? Can you comment on that, CK?
Yes, Professor Lau, thank you for that. That's a very difficult question. I think we have to look at various parameters. So far, the fluid index present in the ICDs or CRT was studied and evaluated, and we do know that the fluid index is not reliable because of its huge false positive results. I think as for example, like the partner HF study, we need to have a composite score looking at various parameters, for example, the clinical status, the activity level, some internal parameters. Of note, the pulmonary artery pressure sensor seems very, very attractive. I think with all these things, if that data could be transmitted, monitored and transmitted in an automated fashion to a telecardiology center that's able to triage and make sense of the data with regards to the patient's clinical condition, and that response could be timely, some form of intervention provided to the patient, then we see a positive effect on remote monitoring or telecardiology in patients with heart failure. So it's a very complex thing. It starts with the patient themselves and the data that we collect, how is transmitted, be it in an automated manner or a patient-triggered manner, and how we respond to it. So I think every step has to be right or beneficial or productive to effect a good change. So as mentioned, how well this system is, apart from just the data we collect, is the telecardiology black box. We have to decide what goes in to make it successful, effective, and perhaps reduce costs as a result. Over to you.
Yes. May I ask Dr. Sato on this aspect as well? Professor Sato, what do you think? Do you think disease management in terms of heart failure diagnostics help you to prevent heart failure in your patients?
Professor Sato, yep. Yes. You've got to unmute.
In my situation, earlier AFib detection is very important to treat the heart failure patients with CLTD, especially that the new onset of AFib was detected. We had to consider that the indication of DOAC overfilling, and that as soon as possible, I recommend the patients to be treated with the catheter ablation. That's it.
I see. Do you, may I ask Professor Sato, do you have a time window, say, to detect an important atrial fibrillation from your device? How soon would you like to act to start anticoagulation? Do you do it within the next few days, or do you have a schedule and before you do this?
F があってからどれぐらい早く患者さんを、
なるほど、
はい、
okay.
ドアクに取り入れました
。It's a good question, I think. And the first, I think it is important to determine the cutoff AFib duration, 1 hour, 6 minutes, or 5.5 hours, as indicated by ELA. In my institution, that the cutoff value, cutoff duration of AFib was determined at 1 hour. By remote monitoring system. When the patient visit in the device clinic, the more strict cutoff duration is used as 6 minutes as a third study. And then, of course, that for the patients, not only duration of AFib, but also CHAT score is very important to determine to start that initiate the DOACs. And I think that the CHAT score is one enough for those heart failure patients. That means that he had already been had the heart failure. And as soon as possible, we have to start the DOAC. And I like to recommend the catheter ablation for AFib for those patients.
Thank you, Professor Sato. I would like to direct the question to Dr. Yu. It's very exciting in terms of technology available. We are having so many parameters being uploaded and connected to make a decision. Can you say, with your engineering background, how much energy are we wasting on the battery? If we are doing too much, and cutting down the battery life of the device, it is sometimes counterproductive.
Right. So I think battery life has been actually one of the technologies we've been much better at over the last decade. I think if you'd asked this question about what percentage of it is cutting back on the longevity, maybe a decade ago, it's quite substantial. But in fact, the energy that is delivered or necessary for long range RF or even Bluetooth is not as substantial as it used to be. So there have been some small studies that have looked at that, but overall less than 5% of that consumption is utilized for remote monitoring. And I think in terms of Bluetooth connectivity with smartphones and apps, that may actually increase that number a bit as the number of contacts will increase the consumption of the battery. But overall, the battery longevity continues to improve. So at a rate that actually will probably counteract the remote monitoring that will cut back on the battery life. So it really is, from what we have now and the technologies we're implanting, it is not substantial. And again, I don't think it's worth not having it on in order to save 5% or less of the battery.
Right. Well, given the cyber security seems to be working out somehow, how far do you think we are away from remote programming of devices? Maybe in an institution without the physician hands-on or even at home? Can you give us your thoughts?
So very good question, and one that we get quite frequently. I think we've just recently been able to roll out for most of the vendors the ability to remotely check devices, especially in hospitals and busy clinics, with their remote connectivities. And I think that was a big step getting towards programmability from a remote site. I think ultimately the most important step will be having a handshake from a product that allows you to make that connectivity. So
There needs to be some security authentication by the site itself. And what I mean by that is I think we are very far away from having the ability, and probably for a good reason, that patients can actually connect to a device that allows you to remotely change their settings. However, I think at a designated or authorized center like a clinic or at a hospital center when they have a certain type of device, we're probably very close to that. However, the security concerns are many for obvious reasons. But the first step was to be able to have a device that can connect remotely without a clinical representative bringing their own device there. And those have become much easier to utilize in the hospital setting. So that is, I think, where we'll roll it out first. From a security standpoint, as long as we have that handshake that is going to initiate it, I think that's one of the manual mechanisms to prevent hacking and to prevent that security concerns that we know we have. And one of the main questions I get from patients are, and partly because the media and the different TV shows have shown this, is currently we don't have a way to hack a device remotely through the remote monitor they have. As we all know this, but patients don't understand this. But we're still far away from that even being a remote possibility, as there has to be a handshake that causes a read switch to then cause the ability to even connect with that device in that primitive way.
Oh, good idea. May I ask Dr. Mittal, what do you think? What is he thinking about this remote programming?
Dr. Lau, I also agree that this is an excellent question, as we probably all experienced in the COVID era a tremendous need to be able to reprogram our devices, certainly clear counters, maybe make a minor programming change, even, you know, a number of unfortunate patients in our area who succumbed to COVID with devices. There was a need for terminal device turnoffs, and it was not so easy now to send someone to their home or their nursing home to turn off these devices, and it was certainly not feasible to bring them into the office or the hospital. So I do hope that the pandemic will spur industry, the FDA, and other stakeholders to work to find a solution that can balance the clinical needs and ensure the safety concerns so nicely outlined by Dr. Yu.
There is a question from the audience.
Right. Yeah, I've got one question about alerts. So the question is how we are prioritizing alerts for emergency management. Prof. King, do you want to take this question?
Sure. So firstly, in my center, remote monitoring does not replace an office check, or rather, does not replace a clinic encounter. It does not replace triaging the patients if they feel unwell. So how do we triage and prioritize alerts? Firstly, patient is also told and educated that we offer a office hours based remote monitoring service. So there isn't a live person watching out for reports 24/7. All reports that are transmitted usually will be responded to, reacted to within one business day. Now, we triage the various alerts based on the severity. For example, whether it's life-threatening events, for example, an unscheduled transmission, it shows an ICD shock. It's in our protocol and work process that the healthcare professional, which is our physiologist, will contact the patient to ascertain if they're okay, and they are advised to turn up, to come to the clinic or the nearest emergency if they're unwell, and to have that ICD shock verified. We triage, for example, if there are any new clinical events such as new onset atrial fibrillation. If it's known atrial fib and they've been receiving treatment, that's down triage, but if they are if new onset atrial fibrillation, they are up triage, and the work process is to inform the managing physician, and then you usually reschedule a early appointment within a week. The other triage events that we up triage would be lead or battery advisories or alerts. If there is a change in impedance, change in insulation, loss of capture,
This would be up triage. The physician is informed and the patient would be asked to come to the office for a verification within 24 hours. And usually in Singapore, being a small place, they turn up on the same business day to have those evaluated. Over to you.
Right, Professor Lau.
Yes, I think we have an exciting session today. Time is getting near, and we heard a lot of very interesting new directions in remote care and remote monitoring. May I pass the mic to Professor Wilcox for his concluding remarks?
Well, I think we have indeed demonstrated a capacity for us as physicians to innovate in response to COVID-19. We have had a wonderful educational session here involving our colleagues all around the world. And of course, our colleagues in the United States are up pretty early in the morning to do this. I think we've heard about both the risks and the opportunities and the diversity of approaches. And I think the future does indeed look bright for this. There's much work to do, and we look forward to further discussions in the future to how to progress this very important field.
And finally, may I probably very soon look forward to at the implant opening a device at the implant, and at the same time, the mobile phone of the patient would be activated with an app to initiate remote monitoring, and that may be what we are looking for in the future. And I also concur with Ian's remarks that we have a very bright future, and for colleagues who are still in the COVID-19 pandemic area, our very best wishes for them.
Right, thank you, Professor Lau. So now we've come to the end of the online symposium. So I'd like to thank to all chairpersons and speakers for their informative talks and to audience for your participation. So hopefully you will find this online symposium beneficial. So I want to let you know that this webinar will be available in video on demand in full on the Radcliffe website. So if you want to review the recordings, please check on the Radcliffe website. So any further comments from anyone before we end this section? All right, so I wish you all stay safe and healthy, and I'm looking forward to the next online webinar. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.